It just filled up so nicely. Thank you for coming. We're very excited to present this first self-publishing workshop here at Bear Pond Books. I'd like to introduce myself. I'm Samantha. I'm the new events and marketing coordinator here at Bear Pond Books. It's nice to see some familiar faces, some new faces as well. Thanks for coming. We're doing this event tonight in collaboration with Ingram Spark, IPNE, and Galaxy Bookshop in Hardwick. We decided to pair up and bring these professionals to the communities here in Montpelier and in Hardwick because we have such a great writing community here, and we can see by our crowd tonight, we're at a sold-out crowd, that everybody's enthusiastic. We host many events here at Bear Pond Books throughout the year. Usually they're on Tuesday evenings. We have events ranging from author readings and book signings to discussions and workshops and even film screenings. Our next event will be on Saturday. It's April 8th, and it's a Girl Rising film discussion and book discussion with author Tanya Lee Stone. She wrote the companion book to the documentary Girl Rising, and we're offering special ticket prices for that for caregivers and parents with their teens or tweens. But you don't have to be a teen or tween to enjoy the documentary and the book. And that'll be April 8th. We're showing it at the Savoy. You can get tickets here at Bear Pond or online at bearpondbooks.com. We also have a full lineup of poetry events happening in April. April is National Poetry Month, and we're fortunate to have Poem City. So look for events in their program, look for it online, follow us on Facebook and Twitter at Bear Pond Books, and you'll see those events. Let me tell you a little bit about the format for tonight's event. We have our five panelists here. They will each speak for about 5 minutes, and they'll introduce themselves, they'll speak about their services or their experiences and how they can help you have the best success in self-publishing. After the panelists speak, we will open it up for questions from you, so I ask that you hold all your questions until that time after they're all finished with their speaking. Let me point out our bathroom, if you need to use it. The back of the store, which is to my right, and to the right of that corner. The back door will be our exit tonight. That's the door that remains open. Our front door is closed for the evening. I'd like to remind you to turn off or mute your cell phones. And I'd also like to point out that we have refreshments, juice and cookies at that table to my right. I'd really like to thank Orca Media. They're here filming tonight. Let me rewind. I'd like to remind it was a good time that happened. And I'd also like to thank our panelists for being here tonight. We have Charlotte Pierce. She's joining us from Boston, where she runs Pierce Press. And she, quote, helps authors' dreams come true. So we look for big things from Charlotte tonight.
Yeah.
Come on down.
We also have Stacie Williams. She's our New England rep from Ingram Publishing Services. And Ingram is a company that's been helping publishers with distribution for over 50 years. We have Roberta Harold. She's our local success story and author of two self-published books, Heron Island and Murdered Sleep. They're both available here tonight to purchase at the front counter here at Bear Pond Books. And I'd like to point out that Murdered Sleep was the 2015 winner of genre fiction for IPNE's annual book awards. We have Susannah Noel. She is a Montpelier-based copy editor who works with independent authors and the Big Five publishers. Who are the Big Five publishers?
Two of them are my clients, so Penguin Random House and Macmillan. And I think, so they merge, and then it's hard to keep track.
There's really just one.
Anyway, two of them are my clients.
And we have Marc, Estrin. He's here from Burlington, Vermont tonight. He is the co-founding editor of Fomite Press, a post-capitalist operation that prides itself on publishing high-level literary work. We're extremely pleased to present this panel of experts here for the first self-publishing workshop. And with that, I'd like to begin, and we will start with Charlotte.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm Charlotte Pierce, and I started my company Pierce Press after moving to Boston from New York in 2000, no, 1989. So, and I did a lot of freelance work until recently. I've gotten more into book publishing. So, we do a more of a collaborative type of publishing. So, we work with the authors and is more of a business partner. So, we share expenses and revenues. And that's on the upswing. I've been acquiring books like mad and trying to keep on top of everything. Mostly use subcontractors. Like I hire editors and designers, and I don't do all that stuff myself. We'll talk a little bit more about that. But and then I've been involved with IPNE or IPNE, as we call it. For about 10 years. It started in 2007. Volunteered at the Mass Library Association Conference. And that's kind of what I was going to focus on tonight. I mean, feel free to ask me anything else, but I would highly recommend joining IPNE or another organization like it. There are a lot of state organizations. There's a lot of writers groups. Who is in a writers group? Yeah, those are great. We focus on the process of publishing, the business of publishing, and our motto is make better books and sell more of them. So, and to do that, we have regional groups, we have online, like our community media, we have a Ask the Experts show, we have Face the Book TV. And these are online streaming shows where you can go to YouTube and look it up and get a lot of information. You have really good people like Stacie and people from Ingram and Independent Book Publishers of America. No, Independent Book Publishers Association, which used to be Publishers Marketing Association, but now we're a regional affiliate of them, and they're kind of like IPNE on a national scale, and their CEO speaks at our conference. We have an annual conference. And I think, you know, it just empowers independent authors who try not to call ourselves self-publishers, because with the opening of the gates, people being able to self-publish or publish their own books, a lot of crap has come out along with that, and there's a stigma. If you walk into a bookstore, don't say I'm a self-published author. You know, say I'm independently published, or get a business name. You know, get a business name. Get a Pierce Press. You know, whatever. Bear Pond Books. Be a business. One of my favorite speakers at our conferences is David Godin, who's a fine publisher, and you probably have some of his books here, maybe. Just really great artistic and literary books. And he says, if you don't take the time to, if you don't take the, you focus on being businesslike about and the quality of your books, improve the quality of your books, then you're privishing, you're not publishing. So I thought that stuck with me, you know. Write your own stuff, print it on your dot matrix printer or whatever, but if you're going to get it out to the world and publish it, make it public, then get a professional editor, a proofreader who should be a different person, and a designer, cover designer. Publicity you can sometimes do yourself, but not everybody is good at it. So these are the things that make a book that will be on those shelves. So how am I doing for time?
4 minutes
more?
1 minute left.
No. With IPNE, you have access to people who are small and medium-sized publishers. We have publishers who have 40, 60, 80 books on their list. We have a lot of vendors, which we call vendor members, our editors, designers, and people who are not publishers or authors, but do the work that you'll need to have done to get your book in a professional-looking condition. And we have a lot of independent authors, probably, maybe 60%. But through the in-person events that we have and our online resources and live streaming shows, you can get to know a lot of people, and our philosophy is very much collaboration. And if you call me and say, I don't know where to find a designer, help me, I'll find you one. I'll find you 10, and they'll be good. They'll be proven good people. So my business card is up here. Please call me anytime. And you also get a half-price membership by coming tonight. So how's that?
Thank you. hi. I'm starting my timer. So. My name's Stacie. I was a bookseller for about 10 years before I stepped into the publishing world. I worked at a large bookstore in Milwaukee where I handled a lot of author events. Everyone from Random House has sent somebody who's won a bunch of awards, and there's 600 people in the audience, and also our local authors who would come in and say, I love you guys, will you please carry my book? I have a book now. And so managing those different relationships, especially the ones where the person who's walked in your door and you really want to help them and you want to encourage them, but they've just printed the book themselves and it's really hard for you to be able to get it on your shelf and you're trying to explain to them what consignment means and what kind of limited space you have and you want to help them very much, but the system isn't really set up for that. And so now that I work for a company that offers not just, sales and distribution, but an actual platform to help authors like those people I knew when I was a bookseller and wanted to help, I get really excited about the existence of something like this. Because Ingram Spark is essentially a print-on-demand platform that allows you to not only find, stock for yourself in your basement and your friends and family and to sell on your website, but it also allows you to show up at Bear Pond and say, hey, how you guys know that I've been working on this book for 5 years? Well, I've published it now, and I would love it if you guys could carry it. And rather than have you show up with 10 copies of your book and have to sign a contracted agreement of, who gets how much, you can give them the information. They can contact us and then order it for their shelves. And then every time they run out, order more without having to actually bother you with your busyness that you are spending all of your time, trying to talk to other bookstores or selling your book online or talking to friends and family or trying to set up your own events or doing the business of being an author. And so it takes a little bit of effort off of your plate in terms of actually getting your books into people's hands. You still have to do perhaps your own work in terms of your publicity and marketing and outreach, but the availability suddenly becomes much more broad. For example, a friend of mine has a mutual friend of his who worked on a cruise ship for many years, and he recently wrote a memoir. He'd been working on this for 10 years. He wrote this memoir about what it means to work for the cruise industry. And, he chose a specific print-on-demand platform. He printed up copies of the books, and he has a bunch of them in his basement. And now he wants to know how his friends in Australia and how the cruise ships that have gift shops can possibly carry the book. And they can't, because he has to try to find a way to ship them copies of his book and how to create a business relationship with each individual organization, each individual, bookstore or gift store. And, try to sell your book in a store in Australia where somebody actually wants to buy it and carry it. And it's kind of difficult to do. So Ingram Spark is a really, really simple platform that allows you to upload your already finished book. Perhaps you've partnered with IPNE, you've been in your writer's group, you've got it proofread, you've, solicited the help of an editor, you've solicited the help of a friend who's a really great designer, and you have your book ready to go. You just need to be able to create it and get it out into the world. So Ingram Spark allows you to actually upload all of that information for a small fee and then create your book in a way that exists in the digital world, and you only have to print the copies you need or want. But what this does is this immediately sets the book into a distribution stream that allows anybody with an Ingram account, and we're talking, 35,000, I think, partners around the world. And those are, we're talking independent, individual businesses. You're talking about Amazon, Barnes & Noble. You're talking about the gift shop at a museum who happens to specialize in the area that you wrote your memoir about. And it makes it possible for them to have your book. And then you only have to worry about dealing with one company in terms of getting your profits. You can also order copies for yourself. The nice thing is that the books aren't created until they're needed. So you don't have to worry about excess stock, which is really important. You can also simultaneously do an ebook as well as your print book. And that's a really huge benefit to being able to get a broader reach. When you combine multiple types of platforms and multiple approaches to getting your book out there, you'll have a far greater chance at success in accomplishing what it is you want to do with getting your story into the world. So we offer just one of those ways to help you saturate that reach. Mm-hmm. But that's my 5 minutes. So there's your very, very short version. But we have lots and lots of further information. You can ask questions. We have brochures. You have a book, etc. But passing it on to your next sort of piece of the puzzle.
Okay, thank you. Stacie, can I get you to set that timer for me too? So
I can.
Nice to see some familiar faces here too, and some folks I know have been dedicated to the writing thing for quite a long time. Let me ask a quick question and get a feel for what kind of books you all are working on. Who's working on fiction? Genre fiction, literary fiction?
Literary.
Yep. Poetry? Nonfiction? Memoir? How-to type? Okay.
Children's books.
Children's books? That's, I forgot to ask you about that one. I don't have kids, and I tend to be very spacey about that sort of thing. And one thing I wanted to mention is that so much depends on what your goals are for publication. I think of them in being in three different categories. One that was big for me was getting the book out from inside me into the world. I do a lot of community theater, as David Klein does as well. And part of what makes it magic is when you close the loop. The rehearsals are great fun in themselves. The process is great. There's a great deal of art in that. But the magic happens when you close that loop and connect with the audience. And just getting that loop closed is a reason enough to publish a book. Another one is if you're thinking in terms of third-party publishing or what do they call it, traditional publishing, sometimes a very well put together indie published book can be an entree into the publishing world or certainly give you credibility with the traditional publishers. And then there's the, of course, commercial success, the bestseller list, all that kind of stuff. And every now and then it happens. 50 Shades of Grey is a perfect example. Mm-hmm. I couldn't read past page 2 because I thought the writing was so abysmal. But for me, I started out with the goal of having my book traditionally published. And I'd gotten the impression from some folks I talked to that murder mysteries were particularly marketable in that respect. So I thought, well, you know, write the book, get an agent, and we'll go from there. So wrote the book, took it through 7 drafts, really was very careful with the plot and everything. It came in at 137,000 words, which is far too big. I ended up meeting an agent at an event called The Muse in the Marketplace. I want to recommend this to you along with the organization that sponsors that. There's an outfit based in Boston called Grub Street. I'm sure you're familiar with them. They offer a lot of great classes, both in craft of writing and in marketing and other aspects of getting your book published or making money at it or whatever. Muse in the Marketplace is an event where you, if you're ready to look for a way of selling your book through a third party, not necessarily self-publishing, but I think they cover that now as well. It's a great opportunity to network and so on. And somewhere during the cocktail hour, a writer friend that I knew introduced me to a lady who ultimately became my agent, and I thought, great. So off I go to my book group with a bottle of champagne, and I say, I've got an agent. I'm going to get published. Well, that was then. Unfortunately, my historical mystery, which is this one, went out into the world roughly coincident with the great slump of 2008 and into a period when historical mysteries were not doing as well as it turned out my agent had thought they were doing. And the long story short is that eventually she said to me, you know, it's just not happening. In the meantime, though, she had gotten an expression of strong interest from an editor in New York City. who said, oh, I totally love this. You know, I'd love to put it out. Where's the sequel? Oh, my God. And I had started working on a sequel, but I hadn't gotten very far. I rushed one into production. She took it back. She did some editing on it, took it to the editor. The editor basically disappeared off the face of the earth. And this is a fairly common story. So after a while, she said to me, look, you know, I'm really sorry this hadn't happened. I really think your book deserves an audience. Perhaps you ought to try putting it out as an ebook. She referred me to an outfit called Smashwords, which turned out to be an excellent choice. Smashwords was great. It required a great deal of careful formatting, but they were able to get my book into ebook form fairly quickly. Now, one of the downsides of Smashwords is it does not, unlike a traditional publisher, it's not selective at all. Anybody can put a book up on Smashwords. So you have titles in there like Breaking Your Addiction to Lesbianism Through Jesus, things of that sort, and Far Too Many Vampires and Werewolves, for my liking anyway. But it got the book out there. But then friends who were, you know, say, oh, you got a book, that's great, but I don't do ebooks. Why don't you get a print version? Turned out that Smashwords had a print subsidiary. Running out of time. And I got it out that way into print. And there is nothing like opening that first box of books and picking it up in your hand and saying, I did this. Long story short, the next phase went more professional, and I found a wonderful woman who's down in Wakefield named Kitty Werner, who runs an outfit called RSB Press. Sounds very much like some of the work that Charlotte does. She helps you turn it into a book into reality. So she was able to take my second book and get it uploaded with Ingram. I cannot say enough good stuff about Lightning Source, which is the Ingram subsidiary that I worked with. Spark came along a little later after my books came out, but I would use it now if I were going to. They really make it happen for you, and Lightning Source is not a misnomer. They really came through for in terms of print on demand. I could order a book on Friday, you know, 80 copies of it, and I'd have it on Tuesday. That's kind of amazing to me that they could do that. So that has proved to be a great lifeline for me. And the other thing that Kitty did was to take the first generation version of this book that I did with WordClay and help me upgrade it to a more professional look. I think a key thing to do, as somebody said, is create a business that you know, has a name different from your own. I chose Station Road Press because Station Road was a road that I had lived on in Scotland when I was a little kid. Also had a sense of forward motion to it. And to get these ISBN numbers, which enable bookstores to stock it and sell it fairly readily, those are two pretty key things in terms of getting the book out and about that you have to do. Since I am out of time, I'm going to leave it at that. I have two little handouts for you here. One is a piece I did for the Montpelier Bridge, which, along with Bear Pond, was incredibly supportive when I put my book out. I'm so grateful to them for everything they've done to help my books see the light of day. And this was just a little bit about, you know, the saga, the story of how this happened for me. So if you want to pass those around. And the other thing, since there's no time right now to talk about marketing to any great extent, is just this website referral that I found today that in which a guy talks about all the platforms that he's used to get his books out into the world. So hopefully that will be of some help to you all. And with that. This is very heavy. Keeping us honest.
My name is Susannah Noel, and I run a company called Noel Editorial. It's me and my brother, and we are based in Montpelier, and we do structural editing, copy editing, and proofreading. And I work with a couple of the big five publishers, Random Penguin Random House, and Macmillan Press, and they have a bunch of vintage books, and St. Martin's Press, and Picador. There's a bunch of imprints under them. So I've been freelancing for them since the mid-90s, and trade fiction and nonfiction. But I also work with self-published authors, independently published authors, and so does my brother. And so I wanted to kind of give people a sense of the difference between copy editing and proofreading and structural editing, because I think it's unless you've been through the process, it can be a little confusing. So knowing that I'm on a timer, maybe I won't start with the process through the traditional publisher. So let's just talk about what it's like when you're probably going to publish independently. So the first thing that you want to do is sort of get the book down and feel like your decisions have been made in terms of storytelling. So that's, I think, one thing that is a little tricky is when you send it off to be edited, maybe with a structural editor who does the deeper kind of the deeper edit, and suddenly you're changing POV, you're changing the plot, you're changing the timeline. You want to sort of feel like you're pretty set with all those things before you send it to an editor, or you just will spend thousands and thousands of dollars having it edited again and again. So that's why working with a writing group is really great. Joining something like Grub Street, taking classes, maybe getting your MFA. You know, a lot of people finish their novel while they're working on their MFA. And that might take a few years. You know, as Robbie said, she had 7 versions, you know, before she really got to the part where she was looking for an agent. So that's kind of the first stage. Then the second stage is where you sort of do the hard work of revising with somebody else. Besides your readers, your beta readers, your spouse, your, you know, parents, your writing group people. But this is like experts, professionals. So this is where I would say send it to a structural editor. Sometimes what people do is they get a manuscript critique. So that's kind of like structural edit light. So you have someone who's knows what they're doing to read through it and say, I feel like you're really strong with characterization, but I didn't believe a word of, you know, that twist that happened on page 210 didn't make sense to me at all. So that's where you get like a great kind of overview of what the manuscript editor thinks, and then you can finish it from there. Or you can work with a structural editor who will help you go through that process and make some of those changes for you. And it's tough because sometimes you have to change stuff again, and you feel like, I've already done this. Like, why do I have to do this again? But it's an important part of the process. So from there, then comes the copy edit. And a lot of times people think that the copy edit, they think that once they've gotten there, they think, oh, I'm done. All I need is a final read through. And so they'll say, I just need a proofread. But really what you need at that point is a copy edit. And that's what I do, and I also proofread. And so what this is what I sort of think of as making it feel like a book. So the structural editor isn't always, I mean, there's little things like fixing spelling and punctuation and grammar. You don't want to rely on your structural edit for that because they're really focused on deep stuff and you want to let them do that job. So the copy editor is going to take care of all of that stuff for you. Then the copy editor, in terms of fiction, I'm sure the same can be said of nonfiction, but it's more important in fiction. There's things that it's amazing how they can go awry. So characters' names sometimes change in the middle of the book. Timelines can be really screwed up. Sometimes night never comes. You know? Like they're on some sort of quest and they just never get dark and they never sleep. And, there was one book where the woman said she was trying to get her dog to stop drinking from the toilet bowl, standing on the ground drinking from the toilet bowl. The dog is Chihuahua. Oh. So I was like, that's all right. So there's lots of little things like that. And then the copy editor will also work with, like, say, ooh, this word just sounds wrong. Or this character would never say that. So there is that level, too, that, you know, you'd be amazed how much of this stuff comes up, even though it's been through 1,001 revisions already. So then it goes back to the author, goes back to you. You make those changes. And then it's only when you feel like it's 100% ready to go out into the world that you get it proofread. So this is where you say, okay, I'm completely done with it. I just want to make sure there's no final errors. And then you send it to the proofreader, and you find, oh my gosh, I did misspell that word, and mm-hmm. you know, there are actually more changes to be made than I thought. And then you upload it. You send it to Ingram Spark, or you upload it to CreateSpace, or at that point, you send it to an agent. Although you've done a lot of the work that the editorial process would do if you went with a publisher, you've already done it and paid for it. So sometimes I recommend instead that you send it to an agent after the structural edit is done. So anyway, that is my time.
I'm Marc Estrin, and I'm going to talk to you today through two very specific lenses, which is my experience. And one is publishing with a traditional publisher. I have 14 novels out there from 5 different publishers, and plus a memoir with Chelsea Green. And the other is a recent activity of my wife and myself. We've made a literary publishing company, and in the last 5 years, we now have 117 titles, very, very high level, many award winners of literature, of novels, short stories, and poetry. So that's all I know. I don't know what it's like to write a mystery. I don't know what it's like to write, you know, nonfiction, or to deal with it. That being said, I want to fanatically recommend that you pursue self-publishing. And the reason for that, there are many reasons for it, but when she said, you know, a post-capitalist press, is that a lot of publishing these days is captured by the need to maximize profits. And, you know, in classical Marxist terms, self-publishing is a revolution. You own the means of production, you know? And that's a really astounding possibilities in that, which are only beginning. Here are the reasons you should do it. You don't have to write query letters and send them out. And query letters are excruciatingly important, but you hear back from 1 out of 99. That was my experience. So there is no black hole in the process. Like, you've been accepted, you send the manuscript in, and then you wait, and you wait, and what's going on, blah, 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 you know? And you never hear from people, and you get pretty jittery, because you're always in control, and you always know where your manuscript is. There's no editorial struggle, and I don't want to talk about having an editor as positive, but there's also no struggle. An editor, for instance, I had an editor, I sent him a fictive biography, and he said, I don't want a biography, I want a novel. And he did some spectacular changes and some very high-level editing, and it was a novel instead of what I wrote. And there's also no waiting. This, aside from a black hole, is this goes as fast as you want to make it. You're in control. You get to design the entire package. You get to design how big the book is. You get to choose the typefaces. You get to choose whether there are headers and footers, and where the page number's going, and what's in the front matter and the back matter. It's all your decision, and you're not being forced by market decisions. You get to set the price. If you're selling through Amazon, there are certain lower limits. But if you don't want to put a price on the cover, then that's your choice. You can come to something like this and, you know, with 10 books and sell them for a dollar each if you want. It's hard with relationship with indie booksellers, which we should talk about. You get high royalties. In other words, you get everything. You don't have to, you know, if you're not good, Amazon takes 30% off the top. But aside from that, you don't get any percentage. You get 100% of what comes in. So if that matters to you, or at least making back the money that you've spent on, you know, the editing of what previously you've done, then getting high royalties, you can make free ebooks easily. It's a 15-minute process to take a finished manuscript and turn it into a beautiful ebook. We do it all the time. You get to design your own marketing strategies. You don't have to get pushed around by publishing companies. I mean, I was sent out to Seattle to read it at Barnes & Noble, and nobody came. You know, so I'm sitting there in Seattle. So what, you know, it's just there. You get to know, to choose what you think is appropriate for you. And your book will never go out of print. It's always there. It will not be pulped, you know. I think a very high percentage of books end up being pulped, which in this world of ecological crisis is not a great idea. So for all of those reasons, we, my wife and I, our company, which I'm not going to mention for reasons I will tell you, are very, very hot on this revolution of challenging the traditional publishers with an alternative stream, and that doesn't mean a secondary stream. That means very, very high quality, as high as you want to make it, stream of literary production. Here are the disadvantages. Somebody mentioned the Vanity Press thing. Well, there was that. It's lingering slightly, but if ever you start feeling guilty about it, I will tell you that Ulysses was self-published, Proust was self-published. There's stuff that just is not of interest at the time of publishing to people who are into making money. If you're publishing one book and you want it in bookstores or in libraries, you will have a very costly ISBN number. One ISBN number costs $125. We buy 500 at a time, and we buy 100 at a time, and that costs $5. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's that kind of stuff. You don't have to find a publisher. You don't have to find an editor. You don't have to get rejected. It's your book, and you have confidence in it, and it's out there. Searching for a house, a publishing house, or an editor or an agent these days is absolutely nuts. It should come with a knife. You don't have to put up, you will have to put up, possibly, with intrusive editing. You will not have an editor except yourself, and you will not have a copy editor, you will not have a structural editor. You need help, and we can talk about that later, because your eyes stop seeing what's on the page. You will have to accept publishers' plans for your book in terms of how much they're going to put out in terms of pushing, marketing your book. And you will not have deep pockets to do that. Although one of my books was published with Penguin, and they chose not to spend a lot of money on it. Mm-hmm. So that's a choice, that's all. So those are the pros and cons, but we're really hot on self-publishing as a way of life and a challenge to the system.
Really good advice. I was doing a little bit of live tweeting because I just thought it was indispensable. I love the difference between copy editing and proofreading and the structural editing. I hadn't known that before. I'd love to open it up for questions, and if you wouldn't mind, you can address the whole panel, you can address a specific person, and panelists, if you wouldn't mind repeating the question, whoever's going to answer it, so that the microphones pick it up for the camera, that'd be great. Would anyone like to start? Everyone has just absorbed so much information. Yes.
I'm not only doing the writing, but I'm also illustrating children's books. I've been a teacher for 47 years and taught in public and Waldorf, and we taught through the oral tradition. So I have all these stories that I told orally. Now I'm just putting them down in writing. But my question is, with the pictures, should I seek out a different type of editor in the art world, or I don't know? I just have a question to that, because I'm doing both. I'm doing the story. The stories are already written. Now I'm working on the illustrations. So, just a question.
Is anyone?
Go ahead. You're the editor.
I mean, her question was, is it any different if you also have art, essentially, with your manuscript? If somebody came to me with that book, I would try to get them to find someone who with a specialty in picture books, because we were just talking about dinner. Picture books are very much their own thing, and they can be very tricky to do. So I would just Google. copy editor or structural editor picture book. And I bet you'll find somebody who can kind of give you some, not only do the copy edit, but give you some idea of marketability or how it might be revised. But it is kind of its own animal, so I would try to find someone who knows.
Are you doing the illustrations yourself?
Or I am.
You are doing them for yourself, yeah. I just acquired a children's book that came with illustrations, which I love, fortunately. But I would recommend getting some feedback from, like we were talking, from the bookstore or the sales, point of sales, just to see what, it doesn't have to change how they turn out, but just to see what, how they might be received by your audience. And another thing I wanted to emphasize is go do your research. No matter what kind of book you have, there are probably 1,000 books in that genre, and you want to kind of know. It doesn't have to be any different than you intended, but it helps to know what your competition is, what people, you know, who show up at the store with $20, you know, what they're going to spend it on. So,
The children's book, though, is a good example of exactly that, of researching what already exists, not in order to mimic or recreate, because especially in children's picture books, the range is incredibly broad. There is no one way to do a children's picture book. It's not, you know, this book has words on the page and you can decide on formatting, but it's still just text on the page, and you're working within that space. You are working in a
format that's 47 years of research.
Well, and that's it, is that you've spent so much time in kids' books.
So I know where I'm coming from in that regard. I just wanted, the question I had was, who do I contact to talk about the pictures?
We don't do children's books. But we have experience with mixtures of text and graphics. We have a category called odd birds, eluding the net of classification. Many of the odd birds are odd birds because they're, they've got a lot of graphics in them. We're doing with our fifth book with Peter Schumann from Bread and Puppet. Mm-hmm. He draws all his books and that kind of stuff. So I can tell you a few things about publishing, POD publishing, which you probably will be doing, and graphics. The first thing is you are very restricted in sizes if it's going to be in bookstores. Mm-hmm. There are some standard sizes. So some of the odder children's books, you need to check into whether whichever service you have will do that and also get it into Ingram or have bookstores, etc. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you're out of that particular loop.
Right.
The other thing is that the quality of the graphics is improving quickly, but is still largely subpar compared to impress printing, color printing from a regular printer. Photographs are pretty poor.
Okay.
The photographs are grayed out a lot. Sounds like you haven't. We have done a few color books, largely as experiments, and they're okay. They're not art books. They're not Abrams art books on shiny paper. So I would label them at a B level of graphic quality. But in the case of these books, B level is fine. So.
Well, although there are now A level, especially for children's picture books. I mean, Ingram's Lightning Source, the Ingram Spark and Lightning Source both, they do children's picture books. They print children's picture books, not just for small publishers. Right.
Okay.
But also for, there are several online platforms where a grandparent can order up a general storybook and have their grandchild's name put into it, and then have a fully jacketed. I mean, I've seen the people, you start to look at different costs, of course, with quality of paper and the format.
Right.
But the quality of the graphics, a lot of that, it's not necessarily on the printing side anymore that's the issue. It's when you upload the material yourself. And that is going to be the key part for, which leads into also like covers. If you have any, your cover design, your graphics, your artwork actually, and making sure that everything is absolutely of the highest resolution possible is going to be key for quality these days.
And don't do like I did, design for a 9x11 book and try and upload it to lightning source because they don't have that size.
So definitely check with you or lightning source.
Look at what's out there and then work within those.
They have a wonderful template generator, you know, so you can input the size and it just won't be available if you put in that.
Because I've been making mock books. Perfect. I get bare books and then I put the text and the pictures in so that I can read it and see how it feels.
That's fantastic.
But I will definitely do that. That's
the
right size.
The cover quality has always been very high. They use a different press than they do to print the text. Mm-hmm. And so even when the quality of internal imagery was poor to okay, the cover was always A-okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I don't mean to hog the thing. I have another question, but I'll wait.
Anybody else?
I have a question, and thank you, Bear Pond. This is such a great place, and I love that you have these kind of events. I'm at kind of a crossroads. I've independently or self-published three books now, one of which is a novel that's done extremely well nationally. And I'm writing the sequel to that. I'm a couple of drafts into the sequel. And I have two other books that are out there. They're more regional and have done pretty well. I've done them all three through CreateSpace, and I'm really trying to move away from Amazon for social reasons. I'm a huge supporter of independent bookstores, though Amazon, of course, has made it so easy to get your books out there. I'm struggling to kind of get out of Amazon into something else. And as I look towards probably doing the same thing, publishing the sequel with a fairly good audience anxious for it, I'm really interested in, you know, what some of you are doing. I've worked with a freelance editor out in Fresno, California for 20 years now, who has just been a fabulous editor. She's more a content structural editor. And I'm getting older, and I want to spend more time, frankly, writing. So I'm really interested in kind of trying to find where my cord could plug in away from Amazon, you know, into Spark.
Yeah, I was told to do Lightning Source or Ingram first and then Amazon, because you get the non-Amazon market, and then it doesn't matter. You can upload to Amazon anyway.
His question, for those of you, I don't know if you, is that when you have, for example, an already existing audience for your book and it's already doing well nationally, and now you're working on a second and trying to move beyond just a single platform sort of an existence, beyond just the idea of the creation of the book itself, one of the options to consider, there are some interesting models out there similar to what Marc is doing in terms of people, what they're investing in and pulling work in and then getting it out into the world for you. And there are two different types of things to think about. One is entrepreneurial publishing, which is kind of a hybrid model of, you know, a publisher and a publishing company that is doing editing and design and marketing and printing, and they're even doing some of the publicity and sales work for you. But you are paying for them. She Writes is a good example of one that does that. Right, a little bit of a hybrid. And She Writes is actually a very interesting example because they have an editor who also does acquisitions editing of the work that is given to She Writes. But another model that's newer is one called Inkshares. And Inkshares is, when I say crowdfunded publishing, it doesn't sound as professional as it actually is. What they mean by crowdfunded publishing is, this is a professional publishing company, meaning that they do full service, you know, they will edit your book and help you with design and marketing, and then they work with a sales and distribution team that then gets your book in front of bookstores, small and large and wherever. But what they mean by crowdfunded is they essentially work with you to set a goal on pre-orders. And when you reach that pre-order goal, then they will accept your book and work with you on it. And the turnaround time is really fast because most of the people who are participating in this model already have a completed book. They've worked with writers groups and editors and a designer, or they already have an existing audience, and they just need that extra push because they want to spend more time writing like you do. And so, you know, they want as close to the best of an experience as independent publishing can offer them, with that kind of level of control and closeness to the material, but also being able to relinquish some of the larger structural systems of it. So that's another type of model to kind of consider when you're looking at whether or not to explore just another physical print, you know, platform where you're still in charge of dealing with sales, or whether or not you step into one of these other sorts of, you know, upstarts who are publishing good work.
I certainly would second your labeling of Amazon as being the devil in terms of corporations. They're closing down lots of stores, lots of bookstores, lots of other kinds of village stores, mom-and-pop stores and all of that. And Bezos is not anybody you would want to hang out with. And we flagellate ourselves every day as for using CreateSpace. But after a lot of research, we have found that for our authors to have the fastest turnaround, the least expensive correction stuff, that CreateSpace, we've looked at all of the services, and CreateSpace does the job from our author's point of view better than any of them, and we hate it.
And that's exactly, I basically raise money through my books for charities, and by far, I can raise way more money through CreateSpace than any other platform I've looked at, though I kind of hate it, and I'm conflicted with independent bookstores.
And we'll have a little flagellating devices there.
Maybe I can borrow yours. But I really am serious about wanting to try to move off that, partly because a lot of my friends who work in and own independent bookstores, particularly all over the Northeast, don't want to carry Amazon books anymore. So you're kind of in this vice of what you just said, you know, in terms of trying to make money either for yourself or to donate. They're by far the best, but, you know, I love independent bookstores. You know, that's where I spend my summer doing little mini tours and whatever. So it's kind of heartbreaking to have, you know, bookstores that you've done really good business with, you know, write you a Dear John or Dear Steve letter.
Just a little tip, if you have, you know what a rack card is? It's like a 4x9 card.
Yeah.
Hand them out. Don't put Amazon on that.
I don't.
They know that you're going to be on Amazon.
But there are some bookstores that are beginning to try to figure out, I'm not sure what Bear Pond is, but for instance, in Burlington, Crow Books carries all of our books.
Yeah, same here.
Maybe Bear Pond does the same thing. And as that spreads, this will no longer be an issue. It won't be in the face of indie bookstores.
And the other thing is, if you go with Lightning Source, or, which I am, or Ingram, Spark, they automatically upload to Amazon. So you're going to be on
Amazon
there anyway.
Digital, you're talking about Kindle.
No. The print book is immediately available.
Spark is the same way.
Think of it as a digital data feed. Once you make your book available in a digital form that is printable, which is essentially what you're doing, then anybody who has data feeds from Ingram, which is basically everybody. Who's large and most of who is small, they then have the information so that a person can choose where and how they want to buy your book. And it is then produced and sent there for purchase.
Maybe we ought to ask people like Bear Pond, you know, in that situation, if you're not carrying Amazon, even if you go through them, do you guys carry those independent books?
Absolutely.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yes.
We do independent books through Ingram and that group, definitely.
Even if they're Amazon linked kind of.
All books are.
Yeah.
You can't get away from it. Yeah. Just don't emphasize it when you walk into an indie bookstore.
What it is that when you have your website or you go in and say, if you're able to say, you can order my book on Ingram, from Ingram, regardless of how it got to Ingram, if you're able to say, my book is orderable via Ingram, that is key to a bricks and mortar space, keeping in your, taking in your book without having to work with you on
say
a consignment
your distributor
basis.
Is Ingram, don't say it's Amazon.
Yeah. Or yourself. It's a distributor that the bookstores are familiar with, rather than the brick and mortar stores will not use Amazon as a distributor.
Correct.
Right.
Yeah.
Not the same as an individual customer will go there and order books. But Ingram is a reputable distributor that brick and mortar stores are familiar with, so they will order them.
I mean, all my books go through Ingram or Baker & Taylor.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I've had several big bookstores, including in Vermont, because CreateSpace is the platform even though it's available through Ingram, they won't carry it anymore.
There's an order.
It's a political front.
Yeah, and I
exactly. There's certainly justice on the side of people saying, get out of this, you know, because you're closing down indie bookstores. It's the last thing that we want to do. But we're trying to push on making these things compatible.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask, Charlotte, you've got some members in IPNE who are third-party publishers, right? They're not primarily what we call self-publishers. They're people who publish other people's books.
Yeah, I don't publish my own books. I started out that way, but yeah. I don't like to write. Yeah. I shouldn't be allowed to.
So those are some vehicles that people, IPNE members can, possible outlets for.
IPNE and you get engaged, that, you know, like we were talking at dinner, you know, you get more out of it than you put into it, but engagement is key with the group because it's volunteer run, and you will get to know people who are publishers, who are looking for books. I mean, I'm looking for alternative education books. Anybody got one? You know,
I do. I could write one of them.
I've done it all. It started with this pedagogy handbook. It's pedagogy is like a self learning, you know, learning environments, and that's a Creative Commons. It's public domain, and so I wanted to get more books in that genre.
Get busy. I've been in the music business for 32 years and have several small independent labels, and everyone here, I'm sure, knows how the music business is going in terms of physical CDs. Even Sony is throwing out hundreds of thousands of CDs that just aren't selling. And in the process of doing a lot of the CDs and DVDs, I've published books. Some of them accompany it, some of them belong in high schools and colleges and libraries, and I always use Lightning Source for those books, and always have just been blown away by how quickly and mm-hmm. what high quality the books that, you know, I get sent. If I need five books, I have a 21 DVD collection of Wayang Kulit music from Indonesia, and there are four books this thick. Mm-hmm. That if I sell two or three a year of this collection, and I need three of those books, mm-hmm. you know, three or four days, I've got them. It's just incredible.
And their customer service is fabulous.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
You will get a response that day, if not.
As a result of my winding down the physical part of my business, I'm doing only digital download music now. I have. Against the wishes of my entire family and every one of my friends who looks at me cross-eyed, I started a publishing company, book publishing. And I have used CreateSpace because it was the only thing I could find that was quick and easy. I've been incredibly impressed by their customer service. Mm-hmm. Getting in touch with people is really quick and easy. They answer all your questions, any problems, they deal with. It's amazing. At the same time, my heart hurts every time I, you know, go that route because I wish there was something else. I wish somebody who had a different model could come up. Yes?
That's what Ingram Spark is, that model.
So Ingram Spark. Okay.
That's exactly what Ingram Spark is you take that book that you've already, you know, that you're done with, and you upload it, basically. And the other thing about the CreateSpace conversation, though, is not just about accessibility and how you order it, but it is about terms. We're talking about terms, mm-hmm. discounts and returnability.
I see, right.
And so part of the problem is that CreateSpace has a non-returnable situation. So a bookstore that can order your book that was printed via, you know, uploaded mm-hmm. and printed via mm-hmm. CreateSpace, but is available through a distributor, and you're asking mm-hmm. them to order it into the store to carry. Because it's not returnable, that means that they are accepting your book no matter what, right. Which sounds lovely when you're like, I know you can sell two of these books in a year. But, you know, it's looking at limited space and all that. So with Spark, your discounting and returnability makes you more accessible to retailers.
My model is She Writes. They're just, I've read their all of their materials backwards and forwards. Actually, this woman here next to me is the one who introduced me and my wife to She Writes. And their understanding of this, for instance, you can't go out there and say, oh, no returns. I'm sorry. The same thing is true of record stores, what's left of them. You have to be able to return the product or you're dead in the water.
You have the option with Lightning Source of doing non-returns.
What's that?
You have the option.
Yes, you do have that option. You can make that choice.
Yeah, but
I think it's
not recommended.
I think it's an almost fatal one if you do.
I'm not sure what people are talking about. I mean, if you only print the books that are already sold, that's POD, right?
Yep.
Then you have no returns.
Yep.
Right? So what's the? I don't get the issue of like.
Well,
we
if
have
a bookstore
no
owns well, orders 10 and they sell yeah. 8 and
the
they want to return 2,
return
then they return them.
As many as they have already sold. Somebody walks into a bookstore, says, "I would like a copy of this book," you know, and it's already in England. As on the database, they order a copy. It'll be here Tuesday. You go in Tuesday. It's there.
Yeah,
and there are no returns.
Well, that's only in the case of somebody walking in and saying, "I know I want to buy this book." And as a bookseller, you say to the customer, "If you come in and want to order a book from a bookstore, and we look it up and we see that we can order it, but it's not returnable, then we will tell you you are committing." You're asking a customer to commit to purchasing that book.
Right.
But I think what we're really referring to is, you know, a local author, you know, you coming into Bear Pond and saying, you know, I'd love it if you would carry my book, which is different than someone coming in specifically ordering it. And so for a store to say, yes, we can take a chance and have 5 copies on a shelf face out, you know, with your name under it saying featured local author.
Exactly.
So even if they don't sell as many as you would like or as they would like, they're able to do that for you, which gives you a better chance at being noticed and spotted and picked up by somebody who doesn't know to look for your work.
But they're more likely to order those 5 if they are returnable.
Right, so that's what that's where the terms matter.
I get it, but this raises another issue, which is if it's POD and it's not going to be on the shelf and it's not going to be face out, and it's not going to be in the front on the front table for people to pick up and look at, then the burden is on your design to have the book sell from the thumbnail and from, if it's on Amazon, the look inside features, what you place in the initial pages, if you have blurbs. The cover design is crucially important. It cannot be too complex. Mm-hmm. It has to say the same thing as Death and Mr. Pickwick there. I mean, that's crucial. And there it is. It has to be obvious, or the graphic has to be very, very capturing. Right? So that's your responsibility.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. With Ingram, whether they're returnable or not, do you give bookstores the usual 40%? Because the other thing you run into with base space is it's 25%.
Right.
Or, you know. So what do you
think? Yes, it is a high... I mean, you still, as the author, and you are still the business, you still set the terms, you still set the price, but Ingram has a calculator. So all you have to do, and you don't have to have an account, you don't have to register, you don't have to pay the fee to upload your book. You can go to the website and randomly you can choose a format. You can choose a paper quality, hardcover, paperback, paper overboard, children's paperback picture book. Choose your quality, choose your pages, set the price, and it will tell you, you can vary the terms and see what the result is for yourself in terms of money in your pocket per sale. So you can do that calculation.
You can't tell the bookstores what percentage discount they get. That's really what I'm asking. So will Ingram Spark or Lightning Source give the bookstores 40% off retail?
I think I can choose 20, 40, or 55, right?
Okay, so
it's variable.
Because in fairness to bookstores, they kind of need the 40% to really...
I usually go with 55. I mean, I don't know if it's affected sales or not, but...
55% discount?
Yeah, wholesale discount.
Wow.
I mean, think about it this way. The material is not sitting anywhere. You're not paying for it to sit in a warehouse. You're not paying for it to, you know, you are not paying to ship it in advance. So while the discounting may sound like, you know, it's a little bit terrifying when you're first stepping in and saying, oh my God, that's money out of my pocket. But at the same time, you haven't spent any money. These are basically sales that, you know, as were mentioned, you know, these are sales that exist when they're made. You know, you're not...
And you can go into a bookstore and say, my books are available on Ingram for 55% wholesale discount. And they're probably going to, you know, perk up. I mean, it's better than 40 or 20, right? Mm-hmm.
It is. That is definitely a perk. Yeah.
We have time for about one more question.
Hi. I'm coming from a very different perspective. I'm trying to make decisions as a first-time independent author. And I came tonight with the specific goal of deciding whether to be very independent or to go with Ingram Spark. I've been writing for very many years. I've been represented by two agents. I've seen my dream come this close and had some very bad luck. So this is a huge step. My new website was just about ready to launch when I saw this workshop. Where I'm getting lost in some of this information is I don't have experience yet, and trying to make the decision of what exactly can Ingram Spark offer that for me is getting lost in the discussion. I understand that the benefit potentially is accessibility, that all of these thousands of bookstores are accessible in a way that my website, we were gonna launch with just independent sales of ebooks and print on demand. So the question is, it's fewer dollars in my pocket per book if we were to go with Ingram Spark. However, there's the potential, obviously, to reach far more readers. How exactly does that happen, though? I mean, what do you do for a self-published author?
In terms of readers, I mean, it is purely sales and just, I mean, it's purely distribution stream is what it is. It's making, when I was a bookseller, and I would talk to, if you were one of my customers and you came into my store and we had this great relationship and we were having this conversation about what you should do, I would say to use every possible platform you actually can. I mean, really, you want to diversify as much as possible. Because if you do only use CreateSpace, you're looking at this percentage of sales. If you use only digital, if you use only one type of ebook, you know, if you use only one type of printer or distribution stream, you want to use every single one that you possibly can. Because then that makes you available to everybody, whether it is via direct sales on your website, which you can do with Ingram Spark as well, whether you're selling them yourself or whether a retailer is selling them. You want the broadest reach possible for your work. Amazon, ebook, someone in Australia, the bookstore here, through your website. And being able to offer that is one of the things that I, again, as a bookseller, now on this side of things, see in the benefit of this platform, because it does allow you to do that. And it doesn't rule out all the other possible platforms either. So,
but what exactly happens? If I went with Ingram Spark, would my book be listed in a catalog?
I can show you exactly what it looks like. It's not a catalog per se. So it's not that, so I am actually a sales rep on a normal basis. She writes as one of the publishing companies where, you know, I was here a few weeks ago and I sit down and we talk about the books coming out and I tell them about, you know, the books are being published by She Writes and the Vermont author who has a memoir coming out. And so I am pitching the book to a bookstore to have them carry it on the author's behalf. Ingram Spark is a POD platform for you to utilize that happens to also allow you another way to get your book into a retail setting, whether that is a physical or digital retail setting. So there's no marketing. You don't have a sales rep who is going out and pitching your book because there are 13 million titles in the Ingram database. Nobody can sell that. So it is on you still to sell your book. But when you have your website ready and your book ready and all you're doing is printing it and then just linking, you know, to yourself for ordering, it's a pretty simple platform. And I do have a list of pro and con blog posts over the years, and some of them are actually from when Ingram Spark first started a few years ago, and some are more recent. And what I like about them is that they they really do break down the pros and cons of each platform, mm-hmm. cost-wise, distribution-wise, ease of use. How easy is it to do customer service? How easy is it to get your information up there to sell books on your own versus getting them into a retail setting?
Just and, to add yeah. to that, IPNE and IBPA both have discounts with Ingram. So when you order a short run of books, 50, 100 or something like that, we have a, you know, you just say you're an IPNE member and there's a code that you use to it. So you can order for your local bookstore or, you know, fulfill that or whatever, your own website sales.
And I would talk to your author here. Yeah, she's
well,
been in
I was
your shoes.
Say, if there's one thing I would do differently if I were doing it all over again from scratch, it would be to set aside and invest some money to hire someone to do publicity work, to be a publicist. Mm-hmm. Jennifer McMahon, some of you may know and admire, as I do, who writes a lot of suspense, thriller, really interesting stuff, mentioned when she launched her first book, even though it was a traditionally published book, that she hired a publicist of her own, independent of the publisher, to help her get the word out about her book through all the various ways. You know, there are contests to enter. There are regional, you know, there are libraries. One of the Self-E, for example, is yeah. something you can get into via Library Journal, which promotes self-published books if they accept, if you're at a quality level. I've been on Self-E for ages, and I've never done anything with it. But, you know, there's always that conflict between getting, you know, keeping on writing if that's what you want to do. If you only got one book, you know, it's you can spend all the rest of your life marketing it. If you want to keep writing, as many people do, it really helps to have someone professional on your site to help you get into all the venues that you could get into and use all the tools that are at your command to publicize your book. So that's the thing I would do differently, because at this point I'm busy writing book 3, which is not part of the series, and I've really pretty much neglected marketing my first two books.
And we have a number of publicists in our membership too.
I'll have to check them out.
Yeah, that's really good to keep in mind. And I'd like to point out, everybody has their Ingram Spark Guide to Independent Publishing, and I'm hoping they see some of the questions that this
oh, absolutely, yeah.
member had will be addressed in this. So look over this when yeah. you get home, and hopefully mm-hmm. you will all be published authors mm-hmm. the next time you see
the next time you see us.
Absolutely, and we know we'll see you here at Ingram.
You can do it.
I do have one little publicity item here if anybody would like one, which is bookmarks.
Yes.
Those are pretty easy to do at home.
And panelists, are you open to taking, if anybody wants one-on-one time with you to come up? Stacie, you said you had something to show possibly. On
oh, yeah, I've got some sample books yeah. and I've got brochures, and I can answer more specific great. Questions. Yeah.
Thank you.
And if anybody wants to sign up, there's a discount code, or we can do it online and use it later.
Thank you.